Good morning, church. It is good to see all of you here this morning, and we're so glad that you came to worship with us this morning. If you're new to Rocky Mount, we want to especially welcome you and hope that you feel not only the Spirit of God, but just a gracious and warm welcome. I do want to take a minute and let you guys know, give you a little update on Pastor Tony. If you're new to Rocky Mount, our associate pastor, Tony Putnam, has been battling cancer and is in his last days. And so I would just ask that when you say, what can we pray for? I would say pray for mercy, for God just to have mercy on Tony, and that you would pray for strength and just abiding comfort for his family. Healing for his kids. His kids have been sick this whole time with, you know, running fevers and stomach bugs and everything else. So if you just lift this family, but pray for mercy. Hospice is there now around the clock. And so I pray his time is near. I just do. Not just for his family, but for him. And so that's the update on that. Here's one thing I know about my brother Tony. He would have you not worry about him one bit, but he would say that you still need to worship God and need to praise God, because God is good always, and always God is good. He said that to me this week. And so that is what we're going to do as a church collectively today. So if you would, I'd ask that you stand and that you greet one another this morning. Pass the love of God and his peace.
Good morning, everyone. We're so glad you guys are here. If you please remain standing and sing with us.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was listens heavy, the chains break out the radio glory. I need a shelter, I was an orphan, now do you call me a citizen again? When I was broken, you were my healing, now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open, cause when you call my name, I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious
the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. And through the darkness, your love and kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living.
Sealed the promise, your bed.
God. Oh, you are our living hope. You are our living hope. What wonderful songs of praise we just sang. That is our prayer, God. Every verse, every melody, that is our prayer this morning. We know, God, that your holy presence is here with us. And we also know that your holy presence is right there with Tony. God, when we don't know what to pray, you intercede for us. When we don't know the words and can't find the words, God, you come, you send your Holy Spirit, and you give us the words that we need to pray. And so, Lord, at this time, that's our prayer to you. We don't know what to pray. We don't know what to say, God, and we humbly ask for your words. When Jesus' disciples asked those same things of him, he taught them these very words to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. You may be seated. I have a couple of announcements this morning. If you have a bulletin, you might want to check them out. There is an announcement in there about the upcoming third annual United Methodist Women's Mind, Body, and Soul event. This is for the ladies in the house, 13 and up. Tickets are on sale out in the Commons area just for $5. This is a wonderful event. It is for mind, body, soul. There's yoga and crafting that you can do. There's a laying of hands and blessing of hands that will take place right here in the sanctuary. It is just a wonderful time in the morning on that Saturday just to be blessed by other women and just to enjoy life together. So if you're interested in that, purchase you a ticket out in the Commons area. Also, if you are new to Rocky Mount, or maybe you've been here for a while and you just hadn't pulled the trigger to become a full member, we would love for you to come and join Sherry and myself and Michelle Hamrick down in the Fellowship Hall starting March the 1st as we begin a new members class. If you're interested in that, you can sign up on the website or you can contact Sherry if you have more questions. A couple of weeks ago, on the 7th, we hosted a wonderful event. It was just a miraculous night, the Night to Shine event. How many of you were part of that event in some form or fashion? Yes. So I see a lot of hands, but I also see a lot of folks that maybe didn't get to be a part. So this morning, we wanted to share some of those memories with you. As our ushers come forward and we prepare to receive our tithes and offerings, we just wanted to give you a little glimpse into how magical that night was.
Folks, that was so, so much work, and our volunteers did so much work. But last week, praise God, they decided to do it again next year. So, again. Ask that you give me a little pass on the sermon today. I really wanted to call in a pinch hitter. I can say it's been a hard week for me, but that doesn't do it justice for what Tony and Carrie and their family's going through. I just really struggled this week with what to say because there is nothing to say. But I have, I do want you to know what I have seen in the last week and seeing God. It just came in all hits and it all hit in waves this week. And, within an hour we had Tony and then we had a stroke and then we had a heart attack. All within 1 hour. And so Pastor G and I went different ways. And she was at the hospital to 2 o'clock in the morning Sunday. And basically his tumor or his intestines just popped. And I was with Tony on Monday morning. And I appreciated the doctor. At first he was very cautious in what he was saying and ask about Tony and have you ever been in a position like this where you've seen someone this sick? And he said, Doc, I'm a pastor. I'm usually standing right where you are, so I know what's going on. Just be honest with me. And the doctor said, okay, I need to know how you want to die. And he said, you can die in this hospital bed, you can die at your home, or you can die at hospice house. And Tony said, I want to die at home with my family. And we got to go over there as a staff Wednesday and say our goodbyes. And I wish you could have seen it. I wish you could have been in the room. He didn't say a word, and he didn't have to. But as we left, we didn't want to bother him or agitate him, but when we were saying our goodbyes, he raised his hands. And even though he'd lost his ability to communicate, each one of us, he grabbed us and held us about this far away from his head and just stared at us and smiled and told us how he felt. So he gave us a gift. He gave us a gift of showing us how a person faces death with Jesus Christ as their Savior. So, you want to know where I've seen God this week? I've seen it in a man laying in the bed. I've seen it in a wife that has released her husband but said that she has denounced Satan and said, you can bring sickness, you can bring whatever you want to bring, but Jesus is going to get our glory. And, I could just stop right now and say, let's go home. But, but then you might not pay me, so I'll get going. How many of you are competitive? I am competitive. My wife and I are very competitive towards each other. Michelle is so good at so many things. And I know that I make fun of her a lot, but you guys also know I know where my bread's buttered. And she is the cream of the crop, and I outkick my coverage by a long ways. But one of the things that we're competitive in is playing cards. And I am very good at it, and she is very bad. And, she's always wanting to play, and she always gets mad. It's either we that play spades or rummy. And I always play on the opposite team of her because we're going to get a divorce if we ever play on the same team. But, you get cocky and everything, and you think you can't be beat until you find somebody that's better than you. How many of you play chess? I'm not good at chess at all. There are some people, you ever seen those people, I can do 5 moves ahead in my head? I can do 1, and that's the next move that I'm getting ready to make. So I always lose at chess. And I was thinking, all these people that can do 8 moves ahead and think it out, how awesome that is. But then think about God. Before the cards are even dealt or the pieces are put on the board. How many moves does God know ahead? And I believe God already knows what's happening and what's going on. So I think God wants to ask us a lot of times, if you really believe that I know everything, why aren't you trusting me more? Why aren't you believing in me? Is it just because I only give you one step at a time? Because you really couldn't handle the next step. How many decisions do you make every single day? Think about that for a minute. How many decisions do you make every day? Think about it. You get up in the morning and you decide what you're going to wear. You have to go to your closet, decide what you want to wear. That decision was taken away from me a few months ago. Michelle dresses me every Sunday now. But she's so nice to me, she gives me two options. She puts two outfits and they both match. So I get to choose, and I think I'm making my own decisions. I'm a big boy, but I'm not really. But think about how many decisions that you make during the day. Which way are you going to take to work that is going to be the fastest route? Are you going to hire somebody? Are you going to date this person? Are you going to say yes or are you going to say no? Just every single day we make decisions. So how many of those decisions are you making with God? And how many of them are you making on your own? If you've got a big decision in life to make, today is the day for you to really listen. How do we let God direct us one step at a time? Today we're going to look at the story of Saul and the conversion of Saul. Now, just to go into the background of who he was, Saul was from Tarsus. He was a Jew. He was the Jew of the Jews. He, in fact, the scripture says he called himself the Hebrew of the Hebrews. He was the best, and he was, at the same time, the worst. He was the brightest of his flock. He was educated at what we would call the University of Jerusalem. He studied God and God's laws and God's will from Gamaliel, which was the man. The scholar of all scholars in all of Israel was Gamaliel. And that is who Saul sat under to learn about God. That's sort of like saying, well, who did you learn computer programming from? Well, I learned from Bill Gates. Or who did you learn how to make ugly tweets? Trump. Or how did you learn to erase emails? Hillary. You know, we all got, you know, they learn from the best. Not only was he the Hebrew of Hebrews, he was also a Pharisee. So that meant he not only had the Ten Commandments. Remember we talked about in the past the Pharisees put a hedge around the law. They didn't want to break those ten, so they started putting outer hedges, other laws. Ended up they had 613 of them. Well, the scripture says when it came to the laws, Saul was flawless. So he was the best of the best. But at the same time, he was the worst of the worst. He despised Christians. He despised you. Everything about you. We learn in Scripture that there was a young man who was becoming a leader in the early Christian church. His name was Stephen. And it ended up that he was stoned to death. But behind the scenes, there stood a man named Saul. Yeah, he was the best of the best, but he was also the worst of the worst. Acts chapter 9, verses 1 through 5 is our scripture this morning. If you will, Canon will you please stand? Meanwhile, Saul was breathing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. He went to the high priest and asked him for letters to synagogues in Damascus so that if he found anyone there who belonged to the way, whether men or women, he might take them as prisoners to Jerusalem. So basically, Paul was over the sector of Jerusalem for Judaism. He was over all the persecution and everything going on there. So he was taking that, and now he wanted to expand this hatred towards Christians. He said, hey, will you give me permission to come in your area and take these people out? So that's what he's doing. It is his role in life, his call, he feels, to go out and persecute Christians. As he neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" "Who are you, Lord?" Saul asked. "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting," he replied. This is a scripture that I think we can all learn from. If you will, let's pray. Lord God, I thank you for this day, and I ask God that you take the scales off our eyes that we've placed on ourselves, that we may see you, feel you, and live by you. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated. So basically, he was going against anyone who was, I'm sorry, I cried, now I got snot. He was going against anyone who was part of the way. They were not called Christians yet. Now remember, this is the early church. And if you read in the scripture, it says the Jerusalem church sort of separated. The reason they were separated is because Paul was out scaring everybody to death. They were under persecution. So the church in Jerusalem had sort of dismantled, and all the disciples had run off into different places. That was because of Saul. And he was going against anyone who was part of the way. They weren't called Christians at the time. Jesus said what? I am the what? The way, the truth, and the life. So that's what's going on here. He is following and chasing anyone part of the way. Now, it says that he was kept throwing out, spewing out murderous threats. Now, there is a difference between persecution 2,000 years ago and the persecution that you and I face right here in America. And God enlightened me on that these past couple weeks. Now, I may make jokes about politics or whatever, but I try not to ever stick my opinion in the pulpit. It's none of my business what you do, and I'm happy for you. And one of the biggest pet peeves I have is pastors that get political. I can't stand it because you're throwing away half your congregation. And that's just not, I don't think it's very smart. So I never try to do it in the pulpit, and I never try to say anything controversial when it comes to social media. I don't want to get into that. That's not who I am. Well, evidently, I said something on social media a couple weeks ago that was blasphemous, and I have paid for it. I've had over 300 or 400 tweets, ugly tweets, towards me in the last 2 weeks. I want to tell you the ugly and horrible thing I said. There's a lady named Lila Rose, and she is a pro-life person. And she was talking about wanting to help ladies that had abortions and wanted them to understand that God loves them and cares for them. Well, I wrote, "I'm blessed to be in a church where some ladies that are post-abortive want to have a study, a Bible study for ladies that are struggling right now." That's the controversy I said. That's it. The first one came back, this is how it started. The first one came back, "Well, they wouldn't need a Bible study if you hadn't shamed them." Wait a minute. We're starting a Bible study for, I didn't shame anybody. Well, then it was on. Oh my goodness, I've never been talked to like that in my life. And one lady told me, she said, "People like you make me want to go out and get pregnant so I can have an abortion and drop it off on your doorstep." That's mean. That's just mean. And I felt sorry for myself. I thought I was being persecuted. No, it turns out it was just an idiot who had a keyboard. That's really what it came down to. That's what they were. And they thought they could be mean and hide behind. Why do we hide behind our little computers and act big and bad? Why do we do that? We think we are so cool. We can write some ugly stuff and look how awesome I am and mean. But you wouldn't dare do that to my face, would you? I mean, people, why don't we do that? But I was thinking, I was like, golly, I'm being so persecuted. People don't know my heart and all these things. And then I read about Paul this week. Just for being here today, he would have you thrown in jail or stoned. That's persecution. Words, they're not going to hurt you. A little typing, That can't hurt you. Paul was out to hurt you. He was out to enslave you, out to imprison you. These people were arrested and beaten, and some of them were stoned to death. So here's what I think about God and how cool God is. God is sitting there saying, let me find the very worst person in the world to show off with and what I can do. Who is the worst person I know? Saul. He picked Saul to go out and convert the world. And God has a tendency to do that for some reason. I got to thinking about this very room today. There are a lot of Sauls in this room. There are a lot of people in this room that if we knew your past, ooh, we'd be scared to sit beside you, wouldn't we? I mean, think about it. How many of you have done some bad stuff? Right? And you're here today. Because God is still God. We have people that are here that are intellectual atheists or intellectual atheists / agnostic. I'm not sure if there is a God, but if God exists, then I don't know if it's Jesus. I don't know which one is the right one. How do I know that? But here's the cool part. You're here. You're here. I wonder if God's got anything to do with that. You see, God chooses people, and he works with people, and he changes people, and he's a transformation God. In verses 3 through 5 again, it says, as he neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice say to him, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Who are you? I'm Jesus. You're not just persecuting my people, you're persecuting me. The scripture in one of the other versions says, the light was brighter than the sun. And here was a man that would rather kill a Christian than look at him. In 30 seconds of his life was totally transformed. Totally transformed. God's grace is so awesome that God initiates salvation. God always has and God always will. The scripture says this, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. In the Methodist Church, we call that prevenient grace. God going before us. You heard of, when you watch football, you heard of prevent defense, right? Prevent defense is trying to stop the people from getting into the end zone. Well, prevenient grace is God trying to stop you from not having a relationship with him. That this preventive care, it's preventive maintenance for your soul. It's God reaching out and wooing and asking us out on a date. It's God saying, here I am, I just want to be with you. And it's happening in our lives and we don't even know it. We don't even know that God's been there working the whole time. And God has been there with Saul the whole time too. But God had to take drastic measures to get Saul. People don't understand prevenient grace. They think they just got up one day and got saved or accepted Christ as their Savior or Lord of their life. How many of you met your spouse and got married right the first time you met them? No, what did you do? You asked them out, and you dated, and you courted, and there were people around you, and things that happened, all these coincidences that happened, that you guys finally came together and got married. Well, that's prevenient grace with God's soul, with our soul, with God. God working through the people around us, the situations that we have. God working through to the point till we get to that place where we say, who are you? And he says, I'm Jesus. And that's when life changes. And that's what happened with Saul. His life changed at that very moment. Verse 6 says this. He said, now get up and go into the city and you'll be told what you must do. Now here's the main point I want to get at today. There's a reason you're not told everything. There's a reason you don't know what's going to happen next. There's a reason that God knows how this is going to play out and knows every move is coming up, but God can't tell you because you can't handle it. What if he had said to Saul, instead of just get up and go, that's the only thing you told him to do. What if he had said to him, hey, Saul, my name's Jesus, and I have decided to convert you, but first I'm going to blind you for 3 days, and I'm going to walk you blind for 3 days to Damascus, and then I'm going to make you start hundreds of churches, and thousands of people are going to come to know Jesus. And by the way, I'm going to change your name from Saul to Paul. How's that going to work out? What do you think Paul would have said, or Saul would have said? He couldn't handle the truth. He couldn't handle it. It had scared him to death. But instead, what did God say to him? Get up and take a step. Folks, that's all God wants from you a lot of times. Just get up and take a step. Just trust me. There's a reason I tell you that my word is a lamp unto your feet. Because lamps, especially during that time, they didn't have LEDs. They had FIREs. That was it. You carried your lamp, and that lamp gave you two or three steps at the top, at the very most in your path. And everything else was complete darkness. What God is saying, I can't tell you everything because you probably can't take it, but I can tell you one step at a time. And my first step is, Paul, get up. Saul, get up. You know, when I don't feel God's presence usually, and I'm reaching out and saying to God, God, I don't hear you. God, I don't feel you. God, I don't see you in my life. He usually says, can you go back to that point where I ask you to do something? All right. Well, have you done it? Nope. I'm waiting. Don't blame me because you don't hear me, see me, feel me. I ask you to do something, one simple thing, and you hadn't done it yet. When you do that, come back and we'll talk. We'll be with each other. Verses 7 through 9. Now, this is the scary part for these guys. The men traveling with Saul stood there speechless. Duh, right? Because they heard all this going on, but they couldn't see what was going on. So Saul got up from the ground and went, and he opened up his eyes, and he couldn't see anything. So they led him by hand into Damascus. For 3 days, he was blind and didn't eat or drink anything. Here's the coolest part. For the first time in Saul's life, he could not physically see. For the first time in Saul's life, he finally saw. He saw spiritually. God, I was once blind, but what? Now I see. He was actually seeing in that walk to Damascus with those scales over his eyes. Verse 10. In Damascus, there was a guy named Ananias, and the Lord called him in a vision, and he said, Ananias. And he said, yes, Lord. Here's the cool part about Ananias. What does that little scripture tell you? Go back to verse 10, please. What does that scripture tell you? Ananias, yes, Lord. That means he had heard the voice of God before. He had been a servant of God in the past. It wasn't like, who are you? No, it's, God, I've heard this before, and whatever you need me to do, I'll do this. Now go to verses 11, 13, and 14. The Lord told him, go to the house of Judas on Straight Street and ask for a man named Tarsus, named Saul, from Tarsus, named Saul, for he's praying. Lord, Ananias answered, I don't know if you've been reading Twitter or Instagram. I don't know if you've seen any of this guy Saul's Facebook posts. But he ain't like us. I just want to make sure you understand what's going on here, because I've heard some reports that this guy might kill me if I go and do this. I mean, he's doing it to a lot of people. And you sure you understand? I just want to make sure. And he has come here with the authority from the chief priest. He's coming to kill. He's coming to get us out. Everybody who loves you and everybody in your name, he's taken us away. Out is the difference between where God wants me to be. No, the difference between where I am and where God wants to bless me is the point where I don't want to get uncomfortable. You see, here I am. God wants me to bless me here. And the only thing I've got to do to get over to this blessing is have some discomfort. And that's what Ananias is saying here. God, I've heard you speak. I'm listening to what you're telling me to do, but I just want to make sure I'm going to have to get uncomfortable and go and meet this guy, and it's going to be pretty awkward. And God says, no, I need you to go out and do it. Ananias, I need you to have faith. And then verse 15, but God said to Ananias, hey, I'm sort of God. I'm not sitting here bantering with you. Go. Get up. You're supposed to be listening. I chose this guy. He is my instrument. He is going to proclaim my name. He is going to go out to the Gentiles. He is going to start churches all over the place. He is going to write 2/3 of the New Testament. You may not understand this, but I need you to listen. So Ananias said yes. You see, God is in the business of choosing the most unlikely people. I bet some of you would say you're pretty unlikely. Well, my question is, are you ready and willing to say, yes, Lord? Or are you ready and willing to make excuses? You know, I thought about it in the past. We want to be Saul. We want to have that transformation experience. We want, when we accept Christ, to have all the bells and whistles go off and angels flying down and all these things. That doesn't usually happen. Paul was big time, and he changed the world. But I bet God wants something a little bit different than world changers and Paul's. I bet all God wants is people like Ananias. We only hear about him one time, but he helped change the world, all because he was willing to say, yes, Lord. And the scripture says this: then Ananias went to the house and entered it, and placing his hands on Saul, he said, brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you were coming here, has sent me so that you may see again and be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. And immediately something like scales fell off Saul's eyes, and he could see again. And he went in hundreds of churches and hundreds of thousands of people, and 2/3 of the New Testament were written, all because he got up, number one, and Ananias said, yes, Lord. All God asked for is a little bit of trust, a little bit of faith, and the ability to take one step. Let's pray. Lord God, I don't understand a lot in this world, and I think that's your point. You just tell us to believe. God, help us to do just that. To trust that we are not just a squished up bunch of cells that came together because two rocks that we don't know where they came from bashed into each other millions of years ago. God, please help us understand there's more to this life than just living 80 or 90 years if we live out everything. God, help us to understand that some people die of cancer at 50. But that doesn't mean you don't love them, and it doesn't mean they're not going to heaven. All it means is they died at 50 and they're spending eternity quicker in heaven. God, we ask for healing. God, I ask for the ultimate healing for Tony now. God, please take him. Please take away his pain. Please continue to make Carrie the woman that she is. I thank you for her witness. I thank you for how she's preached to us. In Jesus' name, amen. Just as we sing our last song today, if you want to come forward as a church to go to the altar, or just all of us come down together and put your arms around each other and let's just say a silent prayer. We got a lot of people in our church that are battling cancer, and we got a lot of people that are hurting. So I just want us to love on each other and pray for each other. And I'm going to say, in the name of Jesus, no one is going to get the flu by hanging out with each other in the next little bit. All right? We're putting that bond, that umbrella of God's Holy Spirit upon this room. All right? So, if you feel led, just be with each other.
Holy, 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 is the Lord God.
music continues to play behind us, we're just going to say a quick prayer together. I know that Carrie's watching this morning, and she just wants you to know how much she has felt your prayers. So, Carrie, we love you. We love you. And God is with you. And God is with Tony right now at that bed. Lord, we thank you for his life and his witness. And God, we ask now that you bring him into your presence. I thank you for this church that's been just that, the church. I thank you for every servant. I thank you for every meal that's been made. I thank you for every prayer that's been said. I thank you for every dollar that's been given. God, I thank you for this church. You have blessed it in so many ways. We love you. We praise you. And all God's people said, have a great and blessed week in the name of Jesus.